We're investigating ecological systems. Basically, ecological systems comprise of two compartments. The one is above the ground and the other one is below the ground. And in fact, from a human perspective, we predominantly consider the above ground system because this is what we see. And we follow up also all these interactions above the ground, see the plants growing and animals consuming what plants produce. The great majority of what is produced above the ground by plants is not consumed by animals, herbivores, we say, but is actually entering the below ground system as dead organic matter. In most terrestrial ecological systems, this is more than 90% of what the plants produce. So we are mainly interested in this afterlife effect of plant organic matter, plant litter materials, and look into that from the below ground animal community. Investigating the relative contribution of above and below ground residues for below ground systems poses the challenge that we are confronted with soil which is opaque and which cannot be studied by visual methods. And one method which allows to open up that system is using stable isotopes, labeling of plants with stable isotopes and then follow up the fate of what plants produce into this below ground system. And the two isotopes we are heavily using is the isotope of carbon, 13C, and the isotope of nitrogen, 15N. And plants build up their biomass using these compounds. So they distribute the carbon throughout the whole plant, including leaves and also, of course, roots. Then we can trace these elements into all below ground animal life or also microbial life and then try to understand the relative importance of below ground and above ground compartments of plants in fueling these below ground systems. So the textbook and public knowledge on the fate of organic matter in terrestrial systems is that it's litter material which falls to the ground, and this is the major food for all the below ground organisms. But in fact, this ignores the perspective of all the below ground production of plants. We labeled actually a beech forest, a mature beech forest, and we followed that carbon into the below ground system. We found that actually the great, great majority of the carbon enters this below ground system via roots. So we are confronted with a kind of misperspective at the moment that we assume that it's mainly the above ground residues which nourish these below ground communities. But in fact, it looks as if it's the opposite. It's the below ground system which is of much greater importance for the below ground community. At least this is true for a beech forest. And the question then, of course, is this a general phenomenon or is it only limited to a certain type of forest? So we also looked into that, for example, in arable fields where we actually used maize as a naturally labeled plant, and we actually found a pretty much matching result. So we have an important function of the below ground system in providing services to the plants and thereby providing also services from the human perspective in plant productivity, ensuring sustainable management of arable but also forest systems. But there is a second pathway these below ground communities also are important for, and this is by serving as prey for above ground predators. Soil animals in fact comprise the great majority of all animal life from a biomass perspective. So most of the biomass which is produced, animal biomass, is actually below the ground. And this biomass of animals might be used as prey for above ground organisms. This is most obvious in birds' presumably from a human perspective, seeing thrushes and starlings feeding on the ground and, for example, feeding on earthworms, but also insect larvae and so on. But there is a whole wealth of invertebrate predators which also use these below-ground animal prey. These bird predators and invertebrate predators then also actually feed on above-ground herbivores, pest species in arable systems, for example, and help in keeping these pest species at low levels. And in fact, this has been shown now via this pathway, below-ground communities also play a major role for the health of above-ground plant systems, and thereby this kind of provides a more holistic perspective of the functioning of terrestrial ecosystems. And we now understand these below-ground systems in a much better way, in the way they function, in the way they are nourished, and this allows to develop management strategies to foster these systems for improving their functions and services they provide. I envisage two different perspectives here. The one perspective is from an arable agricultural systems and plant productivity perspective, that we can foster the functioning of these below ground systems by coming up with management strategies, improving, for example, internal nutrient cycling, allowing to reduce input of mineral fertilizers, and on the other hand, also allowing to reduce the use of pesticides, insecticides, for keeping down herbivore and pest species above the ground. The second perspective is more a conservation biodiversity perspective. The below ground systems, as we now know, plays a major role in nourishing above ground vertebrates such as birds, but also invertebrates such as insects. In both of them, we currently see a massive decline in diversity and biomass in Germany, but also across Europe and probably across the whole world. By fostering these below-ground systems and providing food for the above-ground world, they may contribute substantially to mitigating these declines. So the challenge we're facing now is that we have to extend our scale from the experimental and local findings to large landscape or countrywide scales to implement management strategies fostering these below-ground communities for achieving all these goals.